What's up, Africa? It's your boy, Jimmy, and this is NBA Africa Game Time, where we bring you lifestyle, culture, and the beautiful game of basketball. Now, on the show today, we're celebrating the winners of the BAL while also touching on the regular season awards that have been handed out so far in the NBA. We're also going to be talking to a former NBA player, talking about Roy Hibbert. This is NBA Africa, and we start off right now. We start off in Rwanda, where the inaugural Basketball Africa League came to an end in Kigali. In an exciting battle of the north between Tunisia's US Monastère and Egypt's Zamalek, the Egyptians became the first ever champions of the BAL, winning the final by 76 points to 63.
And Junior slamming it in for two to make it a 12-point lead.
One of the best players of the tournament, Walter Hodge, was named the first ever Hakeem Olajuwon MVP and paid tribute to his teammates for the award.
We did a great job, so I dedicate this trophy for my coach, my trainers, and all my team.
Having a league on our continent means the dreams of many can come true, and we all have something to aspire to. Game on, Africa. Game on. And now the NBA Awards announcements have been taking place during the playoffs. Here is what we know so far. Guard Jordan Clarkson became the first Utah player ever to win the Sixth Man of the Year award for his outstanding season, which led the Jazz to being the top seed in the West.
Man.
Yeah!
Yo! Oh.
A big part of the Knicks' revival has been Julius Randle, and his son, Caden, presented him with the Most Improved Player trophy during practice. Congratulations to all the winners. Hard work definitely pays off. And now we head into the playoffs, where we've seen some competitive matchups in the first round. 2020 finalists, the Miami Heat, were swept by Giannis and the Milwaukee Bucks.
Middleton, you bet! He got it!
The Knicks are back in the playoffs, and their series with Atlanta was fun to watch, with Trae Young putting on a show to lead the Hawks to the second round.
Hawks in transition. Here goes Young. Randle is there. Oh, what a finish!
The Suns and the Lakers is an old rivalry reignited.
And LeBron is free.
In Game 6, Devin Booker dropped 47 points to eliminate the defending champions and hand LeBron James his first ever first-round playoff loss.
Booker on the move. Slams it home!
The Clippers and the Mavs series was one of the hardest to predict. With Luka going to battle against the tough duo of Kawhi Leonard and PG-13, the Clippers won a tightly contested Game 7 to progress to Round 2. The Nets progressed to the next round after beating the Celtics by 4-1 and will face Giannis and the Bucks next. The Nuggets and the Blazers series was chippy, with Dame and Joker dropping buckets, but Denver had too much for Portland and advanced. In Philly, Joel Embiid and the 76ers were dominant in their series against the Wizards and won the series by 4-1. And Donovan Mitchell and the Jazz comfortably knocked out Ja Morant and the Grizzlies. It's clear that having fans back in the arena has made a huge difference in the intensity of the games, and we're in for a treat as we progress to the next round in the playoffs. Dame Dollar is known to be big time, and of course, he recently had a standout playoff performance from beyond the arc. Damian Lillard tied Vince Carter's all-time NBA playoffs record for threes in a half, with 8 triples made in the first 2 quarters. The record has stood for 20 years, and Dame joins elite company. With us witnessing some of the best shooters of all time, we may see this record being broken soon. And now we take a look at some of the top plays from the first round of the playoffs. We start off in LA, the City of Angels. Deep in the third quarter, it's Luka magic time as he dribbles past half court, steps back, and drains this one-legged running three-pointer over Rajon Rondo.
Double pump clutch right there and gets it to roll in.
Luka for three, going 2-for-1 and knocks it down.
Up next, we're in one of the 5 boroughs of New York City, Brooklyn. Midway through the fourth quarter, James Harden draws in the defense with a smooth give and go and sets up Blake Griffin for a one-handed poster on the Celtics.
The shots here have been tough for Boston because of this defense. Almost like Brooklyn looked disinterested on defense during the regular season, but now.
Oh, Blake Griffin hears it from the crowd. A vicious dunk by Griffin.
Oh, a throwback dunk right there once again.
To the Mile High City we go. Late in the first quarter, after Robert Covington assist, Damian Lillard knocks down a long-range three from the Denver logo to bring the Blazers to within 10 of the Nuggets.
On that pass, didn't allow for Morris to grab it cleanly. My goodness.
Lillard!
My goodness. And that was a shot.
Next up, we're in the Valley, Phoenix. Off LeBron's defensive deflection, AD gets an outlet pass from Dennis Schroeder and runs the fast break to find a cutting LeBron James, who finishes the alley-oop pass with a thunderous one-handed slam.
Here comes Booker. Knocked away by James. Another turnover by Phoenix and pesky defense. Here they go! LeBron crowbars it in. Good feed from AD.
And finally, we're in the Big Apple, New York, with game tied at 105 with 9.7 seconds to go. Trae Young gets the inbound pass from Kevin Huerta and drives towards the lane to finish with a tough game-winning floater.
Huerta looking. Back out to Young. Ntilikina guarding him. 7 seconds remaining.
Got to take away the right hand.
Young looks to drive. Young goes inside. The floater. It's good. With 9-tenths of a second remaining in the Knicks call time.
Got to take away the right hand, Mike. Frank let him go to the right then. That's what he does. He devastates.
So Trae Young with 13 of his 32 here in the fourth quarter.
The playoffs have truly gotten off to a great start. Remember to let me know your favorite plays of the playoffs in the comments below. And now we're heading to my favorite part of the show, where we get to talk to NBA players and legends. This week, we're talking to a well-rounded center in the game, a man that his defensive prowess is currently being missed in the NBA, and of course, he was one of the best in his draft class. I'm talking about none other than the one and only big man, Roy Hibbert. How you doing, Roy?
I'm good. Happy to be here. Thanks for having me, Jimmy.
Of the 9 years you were in the league, what would you say was your favorite moment?
First and foremost, I would have to say, I think everybody remembers scoring their first bucket as a rookie. So I got my first bucket against Detroit Pistons. And then that's something I always remember.
With a strong move for his first points as an NBA rookie.
And then playing in the playoffs for the first time. I think we got swept by the Chicago Bulls when we were in Indy. But just getting to know the feeling, the atmosphere, and just saying, you know, this is where I want to be in the postseason. I don't want to be sitting at home. So got a little taste of it. So I remember that part for the most part.
Right. Now, of course, you played for a number of teams in that time in the league. Which would you say was your favorite team to play on?
Yeah, I always had a good relationship with all my teammates off the court, in the locker room, on the basketball court for practice. I relished those times. So, like, my time in Indy probably is, like, my most favorite times.
Oh, Roy Hibbert, big finish for Hibbert.
But at the same time, I met a lot of great teammates, great staff members, great front office people throughout my career. But my time in Indy is pretty fun. I still talk to those people to this day.
Now, you are one of the best defenders the game has ever seen. Now, with the shift to guards and, of course, positionless basketball, who are your favorite big men to watch right now?
Well, if you look over your right shoulder, I'm a big, big, big fan of Joel Embiid.
That's the man.
He is a monster. I mean, he can score inside and out. He has swag day in and day out. You know, he's willing to put his team, the 76ers, on his back.
Oh, Embiid!
I love watching him play, and I like watching Joker from the Denver Nuggets. I'm a big guy. I love seeing big guys go out there and play well. And those two players are having MVP-type seasons, so those are the two that I enjoy watching the most. And Joel up there for sure.
Now, as part of a very good young Indiana Pacers team, you were very clutch on the defensive end, you know, with series-saving blocks. Who would you say, in reflection to today's game, reminds you of yourself?
I would have to say Gobert, but at a way larger level than I did.
Rudy saves the day with a monster block.
You know, he's won, I forgot how many defensive players of the years. So that's something that I never got. But man, he's athletic. He swats everything at the rim. So I love watching that. And then there's a big guy from the Cleveland Cavaliers. Allen, yo, man, yeah, I remember talking to him before the game. He blocks shots at the rim. He's fearless, and a lot of times you don't see big guys wanting to potentially get posterized, but he puts himself in harm's way to go out there and defend the rim, you know. So I love watching him play as well.
You mentioned earlier on that the playoffs is, of course, the most exciting part of the season. Now, who's the hardest person you've ever had to face in the playoffs?
I mean, to tell you the truth, you know, I never got over the hump, but obviously people would say, like, LeBron, he was tough to play against when he was on the Miami Heat, but probably, like, I didn't primarily have to guard him, so I'd have to say Chris Bosh.
Bosh getting inside, blocked by Hibbert.
He was one of the first bigs to step out and really spread the floor. And they would have Haslam or another big guy out there at the five and Chris Bosh at the four, but then they would switch it up and have Chris at the five. So that kind of changed up defensive responsibilities for me with a big guy that can stretch the floor and shoot the three. So I can't, you know, so that was probably one of the most difficult things to be able to know when to help at the rim, but then also get out there and contest three-point shots by Chris Bosh.
All right, I'll buy that. But now let's talk about the playoffs as it is right now. So who's your pick to go all the way?
Man, tell you the truth, preseason, I had Miami and the Lakers in the finals. To be honest with you, I'm not sure who's going to come out of the West, but out of the East, I think Brooklyn is probably going to win the chip. They got too many weapons. They have too many players that are like top five players on one team, and they're able to score. They're selfless. They share the ball. They move the ball really well. They know when guys, their turn to rattle off 6-8 in a row, and they trust each other. So I have a feeling Kevin Durant, James Harden, and Kyrie have a very, 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 very strong chance to bring home a championship for Brooklyn this year.
Are you saying it's going to be Brooklyn for sure?
I'm saying it's Brooklyn. You gonna hold me to that?
I'm gonna hold you to that. You know I am.
who you have? Who do you have?
To be honest, I was gonna say the Lakers, but with the way things are going right now, I'm thinking it might probably end up being the Clippers if they can get through the Mavs. If they get through the Mavs, I don't see anyone stopping them, to be honest. But
there you go.
That's that about that. Let's talk about the awards that are currently being given out. Most improved player has gone to Julius Randle. As you know, the sixth man of the year has already gone to Jordan Clarkson. I want to ask you now, the defensive player of the year, who would your pick be for the year 2020-2021?
Well, first of all, foremost, want to congratulate two of my former teammates from the Lakers,
yep.
Clarkson and Randle, for getting those awards. Those are young guys when I was on the Lakers, and to see them blossom in their respective new teams, and so I'm happy for those guys as well. But in terms of defensive player of the year, it's tough because you can have somebody like Ben Simmons who's like gotten out there getting steals.
Ben Simmons with the steal, and Simmons goes up and throws it down.
Then you have Rudy. I'm not really sure because the NBA has changed where it's like not necessarily a big guy. It's not a big guy award.
That's right.
So I like Gobert, but at the same time, I've been hearing a lot more other players campaigning for it who are smaller. So I would say Gobert. What are your thoughts?
To be honest, I would go with Gobert because he's definitely been there. He's never been out of the discussion. Ben Simmons came in much later. So I would go with Gobert. I mean, I'm a big man kind of guy, so I'd rather go with the big man.
Gobert erases the shot inside.
You mentioned Joel Embiid earlier on. Talk to us about his game and, of course, the talent from other African players that you've seen in the league so far.
So I had the privilege of working one season with the 76ers in the player development department. And Joel was somebody that I would work with. And tell you the truth, he is one of the most nimblest, strongest players I've played against before. He's an animal. Not a matter of if he wins an MVP, it's a matter of when. And he's a serious talent. I love what the NBA is doing with Africa to help bring about like a spotlight to the sport, to be able to like highlight some of these athletes that are coming out of there. Africa, you know, you guys have to stand up. You know, you guys are really producing a lot of talent that's really going to be around for a long time. So I have to tip my hat. I don't know what you guys are doing over there. I need to go over there and have some fufu. So I think that's what Joel told me. I got to have some fufu. So I may pronounce that wrong, but I mean, he said, I might need to come through and eat some food, you know?
You should. And last but not least, if there's any young centers out there that's looking to make it to the NBA, what would be your advice to them as to improving their game as a current modern day basketballer playing the center position?
As a big guy, because you see you have a lot of tall people come out of Africa and athletes, basketball players, but I'd say just work on inside game and outside game. Work on dribbling, work on shooting. Thon Maker, I play with him on Milwaukee. You look at Thon and you see a prototype kind of like potential Kevin Durant who can score inside, out, and be able to stretch the floor. So I would say it's because you're a big guy, don't pigeonhole yourself as just a big guy. Be able to score inside, out. Look at Joel, look at Jokic, look at those guys. You can't get on the floor. You can't even touch the ball on the offensive end unless you can you can spread the floor, move the ball, shoot the three.
Roy, you've been one of my best guests so far. I love the exchange. I wish you have more time to do this. I mean, I'm a fan. I've been watching you forever. So, you know, whenever we get to see you again, it will be exciting for the world. Thank you for taking time out to be on NBA Africa Game Time. We appreciate you, bro.
Thank you. You guys have a nice day. Hope to talk to you all soon.
A very big thank you to Roy for joining us on NBA Africa Game Time. We appreciate you. And now let's get to know some of our first and second generation African players from the NBA and the WNBA a little more. Check this out.
Hey, this is Jordan World.
This is Bam Adebayo.
I'm Udoka Azubuike.
Hi, this is Bismack Biyombo.
This is Chimezie Metu.
This is Elizabeth Williams.
I'll say Wizkid or Burna Boy.
Oh, the Burna Boy, Wizkid.
Burna Boy.
Burna Boy or DeVito, one of them.
First would be DeVito because I feel like I can always dance to his music.
I don't know what it is. I kind of like his flow.
Second would be King Sunny Ade because it gives me kind of nostalgic memories of my dad playing his music in the car growing up.
Even here in the States, a lot of Americans love the music too. My favorite Nigerian food is probably the rice and the stew.
I think Congolese food is the best. I grew up with it, I love it, and my mom makes the best.
I say either jollof rice or egusi soup.
I'm Nigerian, so I love fufu.
Jollof rice with dodo or fried plantain.
There's probably fufu with egusi soup.
I don't know what it is about it. I've been eating it since I was young, so you know, that's just been my favorite dish.
I lean more on like the vegetable stuff, so like the pondu that my mom make is really nice.
And obviously fufu. I grew up with fufu and I love fufu.
I only do Nigerian jollof rice.
I would say Messi.
Of all time, I'll probably say Didier Drogba.
Cristiano Ronaldo.
Either Abby Wambach or Megan Rapinoe.
Like Stephon Diggs, Josh Allen, Buffalo Bills players.
I would say Usain Bolt.
Rather you play soccer, basketball, whatever, but he inspired everybody. He inspired the whole continents. He brought people together, so that's why he's one of my favorite of all time. Ooh, you know I have friends a little all over the place, so I don't want to hurt anybody's feeling.
You know what? I don't have a favorite soccer team.
Manchester United, by far.
Arsenal is actually my favorite.
I grew up a Manchester United fan, so like I said, Cristiano Ronaldo is my favorite player. Like, he's the reason I started watching and you know, following football.
And with that, we've come to the end of today's edition of your NBA Africa Game Time. I hope you've enjoyed it as much as I have. Now, of course, if you want to reach out to us, remember to hit us up on our social media platforms, talking about Facebook, Twitter, as well as YouTube. Not forgetting our NBA Africa Instagram page, which is NBA Africa Official. A big shout out to Roy Hibbert for joining us on the show, while I say thank you for always watching NBA Africa Game Time. Peace, love, respect. Boom!